Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're down here in the Riverside Park with none other than Ron Plett from Fort Madison. He has a group of people that are freestyle trick velocity bike riders. Ron, what does that mean, velocity riders?
High Velocity is the name of their trick team. They do what they call it as freestyling riding. That was invented in California in about 1978 or 9, somewhere along in there, and spread throughout the country. And most of these boys have worked, and these bikes they ride are quite expensive, and they worked and earned the money to buy their own bikes and spend 6 to 8 hours a day practicing to do most of these tricks, which I don't do.
Well, Ron, who is the coach? Were you the coach here?
Well, no, they get most of their ideas out of magazines and watching other guys ride and stuff, and they pretty well coach themselves and work together with one another, and
they're self-taught.
They're self-taught. Well, comes from trial and error.
I can see they're well prepared. We're going to interview one of the other boys.
Wayne Briggs.
Okay, Wayne. Where is Wayne in high school, do you know?
Wayne is be a junior.
Well, Wayne, tell us about how you learned this business.
Well, I went to a show up here in Burlington, it's 2 years ago. And I watched them guys do it, and I went home, and I just started messing around, and 2 years later, I guess.
Now you're a star, right?
Well, not quite, but
tell us about the bicycle.
Well, it's got chrome moly frame, which is real tough, and it doesn't flex or anything, the frame or anything. It's real strong. And then the wheels are made out of a graphite composite plastic, and they'll flex a lot before they'll break. I have never seen one break, but and then the tires we use are just GT tires that are for racing or freestyle.
Well, how much would a bike like this cost?
Well, new mine cost $400, but we put more and more in it, you know, as time goes.
There's no way to get them wholesale, is that right? That's a joke. Well, let's have one of the other boys out here.
Hi, this is Mike Hemme from Weber, Iowa. Mike's been riding a couple years.
Okay, Mike, what's your favorite maneuver in this business?
Probably a quick spin, because it's so quick and it looks pretty nice, I think.
Have you done any ramp jumping?
Yes, I have a ramp of my own, and it's pretty hard to adapt because the curve's different, the height's different, the width's different, and it's just hard to ride someone else's ramp.
Are you interested in motorcycles at all?
I've had one, but they're a little bit dangerous. Too much weight to throw around.
Well, I guess that's right. Well, we'll get back here to Ron. Ron, where all of you had these boys performing?
Well, they performed several places in southeastern Iowa. They've been to Dowds and Weaver, or Denmark, and Birmingham, and where else? Fort Madison, just several places. And they have several more shows to put on.
Where's your next performance at?
Fairfield, Iowa, and maybe the Great Festival in Nauvoo, Illinois.
That sounds like a winner.
Yes.
Well, thank you, Ron, and thank you, fellas.
You bet. Thank you.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning we'll be starting out. Some honeys will be baking the scene. I loaded up my woody with the boards on top, and I put on my faded blue jeans.
Cause we're a come on baby. Wait and see,
yes, I'm gonna take
surfing safari.
Come on baby.
Wait and see,
yes, I'm gonna take
surfing safari. Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning now. Come on a safari with me.
Come on a safari. At Huntington, Malibu, they're shooting the beer. At Rincon, they're walking the nose. We're going on safari to the islands this year, so if you're coming, get ready to go.
We're gonna go surfing, baby,
surfing safari. Yes, I'm gonna take
surfing safari.
We're gonna go surfing, baby,
surfing safari.
Yes, I'm gonna take
surfing safari. Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
Come on a safari with me. Surfing is big in Sunset Beach. They do it in South Africa too. They're all getting stoked on the surfing craze, from Hawaii to the shores of Peru.
So now let's come
surfing
on, baby.
Surfing safari.
Yes, I'm
gonna take
surfing safari.
Come on, baby.
Surfing safari.
Yes, I'm
gonna take
surfing safari.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
To wait and you're sitting on top of the world. Don't be afraid to try the greatest sport around.
Catch your way. Catch your way.
Catch a wave and you're sitting on top of the world. Not just a bed, cause it's been going on so long.
Catch a wave, catch a wave.
Catch a wave, they'll be sitting on top of the world.
Teacher, we're serving. surfing with me.
This is the Memphis Territory Alliance. They're reenacting the Revolutionary War. And there's all the different units here. You've got the British line here behind you, and the American line off to the right here. And right here is 4th Continental Artillery, Pickering's company.
Let's go!
The muskets that were used were very inaccurate. The black powder burns and leaves a very thick black residue. And the ball is undersized so that they can load rapidly and many times without having to clean the musket. So the first few shots, the ball will bounce down the barrel. And whichever way the last bounce takes it, that's the way it will fly. So they're shoulder to shoulder, getting as many musket balls downfield as possible. And that way, they have a chance of hitting something. So at about 75 yards, the muskets start to become effective after a couple shots because the balls become tighter in the barrel and you're a little bit closer. Muskets became inoperative during the battle and they were close enough, they would resort to bayonet charges. In fact, most of the casualties during the battles were created by bayonets. And a bayonet is very impressive. Yeah, they're hanging over there. There. And that is triangular in shape, cross-section. It's very difficult wound to close. If you have a straight cut, the edges tend to fold together, but if you have a triangular cut, the edges pull apart, and it causes more bleeding. And not only does it pass through you completely this way, but it will also pass completely through you this way.
Oh, I see.
And most of the casualties were caused by bayonet charges. You were very unlucky if you were hit by a musket ball. And if you did, your mollies would nurse you and doctor you. And your survival rate was about 80 to 85%. If you were unfortunate enough to be incapacitated and taken to a hospital, your survival rate for minor wounds was about 15%.
Wow.
That's because they crowded everyone in with dysentery, cholera, smallpox into the same small hospital, and they had no knowledge of germs.
Me your loving.